Hey everybody, welcome to this official Global Exchange webinar hosted by me, Sharpan. I'm the CEO and co-founder of Invest, the parent company behind Global Exchange. And if you're watching this webinar, it's because you've been redirected here by a broker, by an exciting link, or maybe you've just gained interest in what we're doing here at Global Exchange, and you want the full picture. You want to learn everything there is to know about how this operation came to be, what it's currently offering, and how it can benefit you. And those are the three main subsects of this webinar that's going to cover here. I do want to do some housekeeping before I get started. This is going to be quite a lengthy video, and it's going to be filled with a lot of technical jargon. There's going to be some assumptions made that the people that are watching this have an understanding about cryptocurrency. Now, you might not be an expert, but some understanding about how the cryptocurrency markets have evolved and where they stand today. So if you don't have that basic knowledge, please go to our YouTube channel and you can find information about cryptocurrencies at a very rudimentary level. And I think it'd be really good if you watch those videos and then come back to be able to engage with this webinar and get the most out of it. So without further ado, let's go straight into what is Global Exchange. And in order to understand what is Global Exchange, it's very important to understand how we got here, what the parent company is, and where we came from. In 2017, I started a company with my best friend, Warren Carson, and we co-founded a company called Invest Bank. At the time, it was called Invest Canada, and we had one sole objective. We wanted to bring the cryptocurrency markets, which were burgeoning in 2017, to a demographic of customers who had hitherto been neglected by the other cryptocurrency companies. What do I mean by that? All of the cryptocurrency companies that were operating, whether they were exchanges or coins or whatever they were targeting millennials. They were targeting specifically 18 to 28-year-old males, as they were the ideal cryptocurrency target. Now, it's not hard to imagine why. These are people that are highly technically sophisticated. These are people that have quick purchasing decision cycles. They already kind of get the idea of digital money, and they really just wanted to get into crypto. So that 18 to 28-year-old demographic was the ideal one. That's what everyone went after. And now we're sitting here in 2019, and not much has changed. And so we at Invest understood this in 2017, and we built a company called Invest Bank. And essentially, Invest Bank is an online banking software that lets you hold both crypto and fiat currencies and access different long-term holding instruments to make your cryptocurrency journey simple. Now, there are other comparable banking softwares on the market, but the one thing that really distinguished us was our distribution strategy. And that was we went into a strategy of acquiring former bank branches. Yes. Physical bank branches to be able to be retrofitted and become cryptocurrency branches. And so we started that retail strategy in alignment with our vision to bring cryptocurrency markets to the uninitiated, so that people that were, again, a little bit scared, a little bit weighed off that it was online, would now have a physical location, just like retail banking, just like they're accustomed to come in and get exposed to it. And so we had an online banking software that was accompanied by our physical banking strategy. We were super lucky to launch our first branch in Toronto, Canada, which is where the company is headquartered, at the middle of 2018. It is a fully functional Invest branch. It was a former TD Canada Trust. And for those of you from North America, you know TD Canada Trust is one of the largest banks in North America. We acquired that branch and we made it into the world's first cryptocurrency branch. So if you go there today, you can get engaged in cryptocurrency in person. If you go online to investbank.com, you can do the same. And really, that was the venture that me and my co-founder cut our teeth in when it comes to cryptocurrency, and it got us a lot of notoriety heading into 2018. And so now, to take the story to the next place, come 2018, the cryptocurrency markets that boomed in 2017 started to depreciate. Actually, frankly speaking, they started to crash. And what happened was all of the great companies, or not so great companies, that were building products started to put their products, their IP, their companies, their hard assets on for sale. And us at Invest Bank, me and Warren saw an incredible opportunity to acquire all of these distressed assets and build a really great basket of companies that can position ourselves as a long-term investor in the greater cryptocurrency markets. And so that's exactly what we did. We spun off Invest Bank into its own operating venture, and we launched Invest Group. And Invest Group is available at invest.com. And if you go there, you'll see the whole portfolio of companies companies that make up Invest. You know, we've invested in incubated companies ranging in sectors ranging from exchanges and banking, which is what we specialize in, to data monetization, to professional services in the blockchain, to media and marketing outlets. Really, 2018 was a matter of investing into the infrastructure and building up the cadence to be able to grow out the Invest group and the Invest companies. And the kind of the last element of our parent company that I think is important for you guys to understand is how committed we are to building strong technology products. And to show the commitment of that, what Invest did is we invested into, no pun intended, research and development facilities all over the world. We call these R&D centers Invest Campus. And essentially what they are, they're placed in strategic places to be able to incubate the very best engineering talent from that area and to incubate the entrepreneurs that want to use that engineering talent. So I'm actually sitting in the second part of Invest Campus, which is Invest Studios, making this video. Upstairs is our flagship Invest Campus in Bangalore, India, where we house over 100 employees, ranging, doing everything you can imagine in the crypto space, marketing, financial analysis, software development, infrastructure development, security. And these Invest Campuses are then outsourced to whatever companies we want to invest in. So we have built a really great development pipeline to complement our investing strategy. And so our flagship one is based here in Bangalore. There's lots of coverage about that. We're building ones right now in London, in Toronto, and we're super excited to expand the Invest Campus network as it will be the largest blockchain incubator in the world to accompany Invest, which we're growing to be a very large holdings company within the crypto space. So that kind of gives you a background on what the parent company has done until now. Our most exciting venture out of all of these is Global Exchange, and that's what you're here to learn about. But it's important to understand who we are and what our cadence is and how super long-term invested we are into the cryptocurrency markets. So with that being said, let's go straight into the problem that we wanted to solve when we set out to make Global Exchange. So again, if you're familiar with the cryptocurrency markets, you know that the cryptocurrency markets are likened to large price fluctuations. So let's just give a quick recap of what we've experienced since 2017. At the end of 2017, the cryptocurrency market capitalization was almost $800 billion. And proceeding in 2018, that market value started to collapse. And at the lowest peak, it was about $300 billion. And now we're actually in an uptick again where it's climbing up. So if you had been just an investor into the cryptocurrency markets, if you were trying to pick the hot next coin or just hold Bitcoin, you would have actually exposed yourself to an extraordinary amount of price fluctuation. And a lot of people can't handle that price fluctuation. That's why when I always explain something to people in terms of the opportunity within the cryptocurrency markets, it's actually not within holding, buying, or trading cryptocurrencies. It's actually another business model within this incredible mass asset class, which allows you as a user to profit in a greater way. And that is to participate in the facilitating of an exchange of cryptocurrency. So if we can reference one of my favorite websites in the world, which is CoinMarketCap.com, CoinMarketCap.com has over 75 million visitors every month. That kind of gives you an understanding of how many people are paying attention to the price movement within any given cryptocurrency, because that is the reason they go to that website. I go to CoinMarketCap.com to actually look at something completely different, which is not the price of an individual cryptocurrency, but what the exchanges, the large cryptocurrency exchanges, are doing in terms of daily volume. And what is an exchange? An exchange is available on the second page of CoinMarketCap, which shows you the total transactional volume that any given exchange platform is facilitating on behalf of its customers. Remember, these exchanges, they're not cryptocurrencies. They don't hold cryptocurrencies. They don't invest into cryptocurrencies. They're just facilitating transactions for people that want to do that. And if we look at the top 10 exchanges, they're easily doing over $1 billion, $2, $3, $4 billion a day in daily trading volume, even when the market is down. In other words, they're making $1 to $4 million in fees if they're charging a 0.1% maker taker fees, even when the market is tanking. Whether the market is tanking, going up or going sideways, they're making money by facilitating other people's transactions. And today there are over 600 cryptocurrency exchanges who have all figured this out, that instead of taking bets, they will allow other people to take bets for no risk. And this became the most golden goose business model in the cryptocurrency space. And the top exchanges, Binance, OKX, Zep, I mean, these are just massive, massive platforms that were started less than a year ago in some cases, and already doing tens of billions of dollars in trading volume. So this is the picture perfect business model. I always like to tell my team, whenever there's a gold rush in any asset class, whether it's a literal gold rush like happened in the United States, or is an equities gold rush, or the gold rush that's happening in the cryptocurrency markets today, you do not want to be the people digging for gold. You do not want to be the people borrowing money, building machinery. What you want to do is be the people selling shovels to the people that are coming and digging gold. They're the ones who are printing money when everyone else is digging frantically. And if you analogize that to what's happening in the cryptocurrency markets, it means let everyone else speculate on where the price of Bitcoin is going. We wanted to build platforms that allowed profit in any market cycle. So now that we've isolated that the best business model within the cryptocurrency market is not to actually invest in cryptocurrencies, but to build the exchange platform, let's look at some of the flaws of the existing industry, of the existing exchange model, and how global exchange can provide a robust solution for that. So our estimation is that the number one problem that is faced by current cryptocurrency users who use exchanges, and will be faced in the future with ever growing degrees of complexity, is the storage and custody of private keys. In other words, where is the money being stored that's being traded on the platform? So again, this is one of those topics that will require you to have a bit of understanding on the cryptocurrency space, but I'm actually going to take some time here to address it. When you own cryptocurrencies, the only thing that actually bestows upon you the ownership of that is who is holding the private keys, which are encrypted ledger keys that allow you to prove to the blockchain that you're holding these assets. When you're using a centralized exchange like the ones that I mentioned above that are making all the money, you are foregoing the ownership of your private keys to that exchange platform. What that means is you are transferring the money from your computer where it's supposed to be to the exchange's computer so that you can trade on the exchange. This presents two problems that are going to have dire consequences for the cryptocurrency market. So when you give up your private keys and you leave your money on the exchange, number one thing that will happen, if it didn't happen to you already, it's just a matter of time, is negligence on behalf of the company. In other words, they will either shut down or there will be some incident that forces them to shut down, whether that's a hack, whether that's just them running off with the money, whether that's legal issues. And since they are holding all of the customers' cryptocurrencies, there is no legal or technical recourse that you can have to get your money back. When you give them your private keys, it is now their money. You are just seeing numbers on a screen. So the company, hopefully this doesn't happen, but it's just proven to happen so many times, has the authority to leave with all the money. That's what we would define as negligence on behalf of the company. The second issue, which is even more devastating, is that the exchange platform will get hacked. In other words, malicious third-party actors will penetrate the database of the exchange and take all the money. And this requires a little bit of nuanced understanding about how blockchains work. For example, if someone is to hack a bank and take your money from the bank, you have a lot of legal recourse as to what you can do with that. You can call the bank could call the counterparty bank. There's lots of intertwined networks that can regulate that. If someone hacks a cryptocurrency exchange, they are walking off with 5, 10, 50, hundreds of millions of dollars, as it's happened since the beginning of cryptocurrencies, and there's nothing you or the exchange can do about it. Let's look at the computer science as to why that occurs. Let's say there are 10 people in this room that all have Bitcoin. Let's say everyone has $100 of Bitcoin on their computer. They might have it on their phone, they might have it on their computer. Now, if a hacker wants to get in and steal Bitcoin, he has to go through 10 encryption schemes. He has to break into 10 devices, and he still doesn't know how much money is going to be on the other side of that encryption scheme. It could be $1 million or it could be no money. There's no guaranteed reward for the hacker. However, let's say all 10 of us then take the money and put it on an exchange. Now, instead of having 10 computers that have $100, you have one computer that has $1,000. And the hacker knows that when he gets into that one encryption system, there is a big prize on the other side. And we're not talking about 10, $100, 10 customers. We're talking about hundreds of millions of dollars. As I said, billions of dollars traded on these exchanges. Imagine for a hacker that wants to get into that, how lucrative that is. Since 2012, there have been over $6 billion in theft, not even loss, theft for cryptocurrencies, because the exchanges make it so easy for people to get in and steal. There's no recourse for that. So those two issues are the tremendous issues facing exchanges today, and that even though the business model is so sweet, they are not getting rectified. Actually, the reason that the exchanges don't rectify these issues is because a centralized business model allows them to make such great profits, and it doesn't pay them to change this business model. And we haven't even seen what's gonna happen as the cryptocurrency markets emerges over 800 billion, it goes into the trillions of dollars. These two problems will become tremendously important to solve. So 16 months ago, me and my team set out to solve the problem of custody and liquidity markets. In other words, who stores the cryptocurrency and where are the order books? And to understand how we came to our solution, you have to look at what the industry has brought up as a solution, because all of these things I've told you about how cryptocurrency exchanges work are not even things that we talked about first. The leading CEOs, the CEOs of exchanges, founders of exchanges, the security architects that built blockchains themselves have all espoused this same claim. They've just all taken different approaches as to how to fix it. And we at Global Exchange wanted to take a novel approach as to how we can blend these incredible platforms that function as exchanges with secure storage of cryptocurrency and make a simple to use user interface that customers can engage with. And that is the point of the Global Exchange operating system. Now, in order to identify what it is that we solved, we will go into the different products that we presented and kind of how we thought about the operating system as a whole.